Welcome to High Point University's Access to Innovators series. Join us now as we explore the life of Condoleezza Rice, our nation's former Secretary of State, former Provost at Stanford University, and an accomplished author.
High Point University presents A Conversation with Condoleezza Rice and Nido Qubein is a production of UNC-TV in association with High Point University.
Thank you very much and welcome to High Point University. This is another one of those days when we invite some incredibly talented thought leaders from across America and the world to come and share with our students and to share with each of you and all of you some ideas for today and for tomorrow that can make our country, our family, our life, our work even better. And today, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor, it is our privilege at High Point University to introduce to you the 66th Secretary of State of the United States of America, Dr. Condoleezza Rice. Madam Secretary, Dr. Rice, welcome to High Point University.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
We're delighted that you're here. We've been looking forward to this moment. I have read all your books. I am ready for you. Boy, do I have questions for you. I have some really good questions. I have a whole book filled with them.
Oh, I'm glad, but as I told you backstage, I teach 19-year-olds. There's nothing I haven't been asked, so I look forward to it.
Dr. Rice, your life has been nothing short of amazing. You are the American dream personified. You're the only child of a Presbyterian minister and a school teacher. You grew up in the Deep South. You were born in Birmingham, Alabama, a time of segregation. You became a classical pianist, an accomplished ice skater, and the first woman and the first African American to become the provost of Stanford University, and you did it at age 38. You are the 66th Secretary of State, United States of America, and before that on the National Security Council. You're one of two females ever inducted in the Augusta National Golf Club. Hello. And you served on all the big boards, Chevron, Hewlett-Packard, Transamerica, all the ones that pay big money. 4 times, Time magazine listed you as one of the world's most influential people. Not once, not twice, not thrice, but 4 times. Even the NFL floated your name as a potential commissioner. I have a question for you. How does anyone, much less an African-American girl from segregated Alabama, how can anyone achieve such levels of extraordinary achievement? This is incredible. What is your secret?
Well, thank you. First of all, it's wonderful to be here at High Point. What a beautiful university, and I met a few of your students. They're terrific, and I look forward to the commencement celebration. It's such a great time for families and for the kids and for young people, so I'm looking forward to it. And it is in part a way to understand my story, because in my family, starting all the way back with my grandparents, education was core to everything. My parents really believed that if you had a high quality education, there is nothing that you couldn't do. You would be armored against segregation, armored against hatred, armored against prejudice. And so the idea that you couldn't control your circumstances, but you could control your response to your circumstances, and education gave you a way to control that response, it was just core to who we were. I was also fortunate to grow up in a very loving family, a very loving community in Birmingham, a kind of little middle-class enclave in Birmingham. And it was faith, family, and education. And I always say that the only reason that I'm where I am now is because John and Angelina Rice were extraordinary, ordinary people. They were ordinary in teacher, minister, later on university administrator, but they were extraordinary in what they wanted for their little girl and all of the kids in the community. And they and their friends delivered despite the circumstances. So it goes back to family and faith and education.
In fact, it was your grandmother who began teaching you piano at age three.
That's right.
And you wanted a piano so badly.
That's right.
And your father said, I'll get you a piano if...
My father said, I will get you a piano. I was just about to be four. I'd been playing for about half a year. And my father said, I'll get you a piano when you learn to play What a Friend We Have in Jesus perfectly. Because my grandmother, who was a very religious woman, taught her students progressively more difficult hymns to teach them to play the piano. So my parents and my grandmother said that the next day, when my parents dropped me off at her house, they were working, I sat at that piano for 8 hours. I would not even stop for lunch. And I practiced, and I practiced. And when my parents came home, I knew What a Friend We Have in Jesus perfectly. My father, my poor father, on his minister's guidance counselor salary and my mother's teacher salary, couldn't afford a piano. I learned later on they went out and they rented a piano on one of those rent-to-own kinds of things.
Yes.
And I had a chance to get my piano. But my grandmother was an amazing woman who was classically trained and who taught lots of kids for 25 cents a lesson. And fortunately, she started me very, very early, and I'm grateful to this day that that I still have the piano. Now, I also am grateful to my mother for something, because this is something about parenting in those days. When I was about 10, having played from the time I was four, I went to my mother and I announced that I was quitting. I was tired of the piano. And she said, "You're not old enough or good enough to make that decision." And I kept playing, and I'm very grateful that I did.
And we're grateful that you did, because you went on to play Mozart with the Symphony Orchestra at Denver. You performed for Queen Elizabeth.
Yes.
You played with Yo-Yo Ma.
Yes.
You must have incredible discipline.
Well, now, let's not get carried away. I didn't play for Queen Elizabeth and with Yo-Yo Ma because I was the world's greatest pianist. I played because I was the National Security Advisor and the Secretary of State who could play the piano. And so I wasn't confused about why I was playing with them. But I love to play, and I love to practice. I still try to practice about an hour, hour and a half most days. And I still play benefit concerts. I have a collaboration with a string quartet in Boston, the Muir String Quartet. They're a professional quartet in residence at Boston University. And every year we play a concert and we give the money to something that we started called Classics for Kids, which puts instruments into the schools. Because as you know, our schools are not doing much in the arts these days with budget cuts and the like. And so we give kids a chance to learn to play music as we learn to play.
That's wonderful. You know, your whole life has been about the mentors in your life. You just mentioned your grandparents and your parents. You speak of your father in glowing terms in your books. You talk about the influence and the impact he's had in your life. Your dad went on to heaven on Christmas Eve at age 77. And at his funeral, you played. And you played in the garden.
That's right.
Dr. Rice, can I impose on you not to play, but to read the words?
Of course. I come to the garden alone where the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God disposes. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own. And the voice, joys we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. My father used to,
you
don't want me to sing. Play the piano, maybe. Sing, no. My father, toward the end of his life, had a, what they call an anoxic brain injury. So He was not fully conscious, although he made a pretty good recovery. And he would sing that song over and over. Mm. And it just shows you that that faith is very deep in people. And no matter their physical circumstances, they are still attached to the faith and to those great old songs that are comforts to us all.
No question about it. It's a when you speak about mentoring, you speak about it frankly, and you speak about it powerfully. And on pages 46 and 47 of your book titled Extraordinary Ordinary People, you say this, and I'd like to invite you to comment on it, if you will, please. You said the schools were too completely segregated in Birmingham. There were no white teachers, no white students. Education in Alabama was well behind the rest of the country. And I'm skipping a bit. Teachers had high expectations and were pretty tough on low performers. To succeed, they routinely reminded us, you will have to be twice as good. This was declared as a matter of fact, not a point for debate. We love you, and we will give you everything we can to help you succeed, they would say. But there are no excuses, and there is no place for victims.
That's what I mean by the belief that you might not be able to control your circumstances, but you could control your response to your circumstances. I tell my students now that it's not a bad mantra to say, I'm going to have to be twice as good, whatever color you are, whatever gender you are, because then you will work twice as hard. And you'll be confident, and you'll be certain of your abilities, and you'll be able to deliver. But these were people who, in segregated Birmingham, where they could have had really limited horizons for their kids. As you can imagine, this was a place where I could not go to a movie theater or to a restaurant with my parents until the Civil Rights Act passed when I was 8. It was a place of unspeakable violence in 1963. I lost a classmate in the 16th Street Birmingham church bombing, Baptist church bombing. And so they could have had very limited horizons, but instead they had high expectations. You can do anything you want to be. I've often said my parents had me absolutely convinced that I might not be able to have a hamburger at the Woolworth's lunch counter, but I could be president of the United States if I wanted to be. And so they taught us to believe in our ability to exceed. And the no victims line was very important, because it could have been that with all that was going on around you, you had plenty to blame for your inability to succeed. But they simply wouldn't let us blame anyone. They said, don't let somebody else's racism be your problem.
And you tell a powerful story at Christmas time when you and your father went somewhere where Santa Claus was sitting, and?
Well, I was about 5 years old, and you know the drill. You take your kid to see Santa Claus, and Santa Claus is sitting there, and the Santa Claus says, puts the kid on the knee and says, so what would you like, little girl? Well, this particular Santa Claus was taking all of the little black children and holding them out here, and taking all the little white children and putting them on his knee. And my father said, Angelina, he said, if he does that to Condoleezza, I am going to go pull all that stuff off him and expose him for exactly what he is. Well, you might imagine this little five-year-old, Santa Claus daddy, how's this going to turn out? Well, my father was an imposing man. He was about 6'2" and a former football player. And Santa Claus must have read his body language, because when I came along, Santa Claus took me, put me on his knee, said, so little girl, what will you have for Christmas? And so all's well that ends well.
Yes.
They say we are what we eat, what we read, what we surround ourselves with. I choose to be extraordinary, and I get my start every day with daily motivation.
In our global economy, where a million people can do what you can do, you have to compete with your differences. That something extra that you possess, that something extra is your differential advantage, your DA. Are you passionate? That answer must be a resounding yes. Knowing and using and understanding your differential advantage will help you on your quest for excellence.
Sign up today to receive daily motivation. A short lesson each Monday with your video life coach, Nido Qubein, an and inspirational quotes the rest of the week. It's relevant, quick, and free. Choose to be extraordinary.
Dr. Rice, take us back into the window of your life just a bit. I have some questions for you that you take them any way you choose. What was your proudest moment in your life?
Well, my proudest moments have always had to do with the opportunity to think that I might be making a difference in somebody else's life. And so from different parts of my life, different aspects of it, I've had variability in what were proud moments. The student, you've had this, the student who comes back to say, I was really lost and I took your class, or I heard you speak and I knew where I wanted to go, because that's what happened to me. That's how I became a Soviet specialist, because a faculty member, a professor, taught a class that I loved, and I thought, that's what I want to do. Those moments, I'm really proud of what I still consider to be my primary profession, which is professor. Mm-hmm. As Secretary of State, I think it was whenever I had the opportunity to represent this extraordinary country. I remember getting off the plane the first time, and it said the United States of America behind me. And I thought, well, that's really something. But recognizing that, yes, the United States is powerful, has a powerful military, huge economy, but we also lead from compassion. We also lead from values. And very often, I would encounter children who, in their very own way, were saying, I know about America. So I was in China shortly after the earthquake at Chengdu. And a little boy came up to me and he said, you're that lady from America, aren't you? He must have been 12 years old or so. And I thought, yes, I'm that lady from America. Or one of my favorite moments when I was in a place that you know well in the Middle East, and a Shia cleric, very conservative man, very hardline in Iraq, and I had this rather difficult meeting. And at the end of the meeting, he said, would you do me a favor? He spoke no English, the translator. I said, do you a favor? Sure, had no idea what he was gonna ask. He said, my 13-year-old granddaughter just loves you. She watches you on television. And she and her mother are coming to Washington. Would you meet them at the State Department? I said, sure. So I'm there, and in walks this little 13-year-old girl. She's wearing a pink T-shirt that says Princess. And she comes bounding up to me and she says, I want to be foreign minister too. And I thought, how wonderful that I had a chance, even with her grandfather, this tough man, to see the gleam in his eye about his daughter, his granddaughter. It said to me, he knows too that something better is coming for women in the Middle East. And so I think America has an opportunity to model these values and this sense of opportunity and this sense of overcoming difficulty. And it was really those moments that were proudest for me.
Tell us about a time that you were afraid.
Yeah. Post 9/11, I was really afraid. Not for myself. You don't have a sense of personal vulnerability in those times. But I was the National Security Advisor on the day when nearly 3,000 people died. I watched film of people jumping out of 80-story windows. And the fear of the follow-on attack was absolute in those days after. I've often said that every day after September 11th felt like September 12th. We had done everything we knew to do, but we obviously hadn't done enough, or it wouldn't have happened. And you feel enormous personal responsibility for that. And so every day you get up with a knot in your stomach. What is coming now? What door is going to open? What is going to pop out? And we often forget now, with the 15 years or so behind us, that we were immediately facing anthrax attacks, which we thought were attributable to Al-Qaeda. They turned out to be domestic. There was a radiological scare about Washington, D.C. Those were very frightening times, not for yourself personally, but for the country.
Yes, of course. How about your biggest failure? You've achieved so much in your life. I'm sure you've had some productive failures. Yeah. What would be one that would be a learning moment for all of us?
Well, you have to strike when the iron is hot. And let me give you two examples. One may surprise you a little bit. I know that we are a country of immigrants. I know that this country's vitality, its youth, comes from immigration. And in 2001, President George W. Bush, who had been governor of Texas, and Vicente Fox, the president of Mexico at the time, about to become the president of Mexico, also a Mexican governor, wanted to fix the immigration problem. They wanted to do comprehensive immigration reform. And then 9/11 happened. And we put everything else on the back burner. And it wasn't until 2007 that we took it up again. And now it was too late. We were out of steam. I wish that we'd solved it then, because maybe some of the divisive and ugly debates that we're having now would not have been happening had we done the right thing then. A second one is that we were very close in November of 2008 to having a Palestinian state, an agreement between the Israelis and the Palestinians. Ehud Olmert, who was the prime minister, was in legal trouble, which ultimately sent him to jail, but legal trouble and political trouble. The Palestinians decided they were basically going to wait for a better deal, but this was an amazing deal. In retrospect, I wish we had insisted more, or perhaps published the deal. But we wanted to leave it to the next administration so they could take it up and circumstances, and now we're further than ever from peace in the Middle East. And so those are two chances that I think we had to do things differently. There are lots of them. You know, when you are leading in consequential times, you make mistakes. I would, again, be happy to see Saddam Hussein go, because I believe he was a cancer in the Middle East. But we didn't do a very good job of rebuilding the country after the war until 2007. So to know those lessons earlier. So yes, there are many, many things I wish we could have done differently.
So how would you have resolved the immigration issue? What would have been the solution?
Well, the idea that was supported, by the way, by John McCain, John Kyle of Arizona, Ted Kennedy, George W. Bush, you would think that'd be kind of a wide spectrum. The idea was that people who've been here for years, in some cases people who've only been here, are not going to go home, and you're not going to deport. We're not going to deport 12 million people. We're not going to do it. And so to make them pay a fine, go to the back of the line in terms of citizenship, but if you have a job, you get a work permit, and you work on a work permit so that people can come out of the shadows. Secondly, secure the border, or perhaps first, secure the border so that you stop the problem from continuing. And then finally, to do something about immigration at the high end, where I live in the Silicon Valley. Were it not for immigrants on HB1 visas, which are for high-skilled people in engineering and computer science and the like, we would not have the circumstances that we have in the high-tech revolution. You have enough of it around here in the research triangle. Yes. And so there were really three very important elements to it. Unfortunately, it didn't get done.
Give us just a little bit behind the scenes view of how does a Secretary of State operate. So you are going to visit a country, you have some difficult issues to resolve. You obviously do your homework prior to departure. You obviously have an advanced team that goes there and talks and organizes. But walk us in the room. We're walking in the room. It's you. It's them. You're trying to resolve something. How does this work? Do you ever cuss at each other? Do you talk nicely to each other?
But it depends on the person as to how you... Look, the first thing is that any person who's about to negotiate on behalf of their country recognizes that there are certain constraints. And those constraints are really of two kinds. One is your U.S. interest. So you're going to try to make a deal, but never in a way that abridges U.S. interest. And secondly, you're working within the context of an administration that has a view, most especially a president who has a view. So whenever I was about to go and work on a difficult thing, the first thing I wanted to do was to make sure the president and I were on the same page. You then develop positions, talk to the Secretary of Defense and others about the positions depending on the interest involved. Usually the other secretaries are bombarding you with, could you raise this question? But I spent more time with Vladimir Putin on accepting American pork imports and trying to convince him that we had only had three cases of trichinosis in the last 10 years. Do you believe I was actually talking to him about this? But I was, because U.S. imports is an important thing. So you'll get a list of things that people want you to raise as well. Then you walk into the room, well prepared, and I found at that moment the most important thing to be was a good listener. Because, yes, you're going to present your point of view, but you're also listening for points of overlap with the other person's point of view. People will have told you there is no way to come to an agreement. But if you're listening very carefully and you can explore back and forth, you might just hear that one thing that gives you a way to solve the issue. Then after, you go and you meet the press. And the press is always there waiting to say that the negotiation was a failure. Under the best of circumstances, you and your negotiating partner go out together, you explain how you've made progress, you explain how there's still more progress to be made. But under the worst of circumstances, you have to go out and say, it's not working, and we have more work to do. And just put up with the nasty headlines about how you didn't succeed.
But you go in with a floor that this is the minimum that I would settle for. This is the maximum that I would give. This is the optimum we're shooting for.
You do, but it might move. Because if their maximum or their minimum looks pretty good to you, then you might move your minimum. Mm-hmm. And at that point, you also want to have the confidence of the president. I always thought that my strongest asset as Secretary of State was that the president had confidence in me. He knew that I was not going to push beyond his limits without talking to him. And so I was free to go out and negotiate. I didn't have to constantly phone home. Mm-hmm. And I knew where the boundaries were. So if I heard something from Sergei Lavrov, the foreign minister of Russia, I would say, okay, I think, Sergei, we can work with that. Because it's important, too, that your counterparts know that the president is backing you and that you speak for the entire United States of America. The worst thing that can happen to you is to be undercut at home.
Tell us about a moment when you wanted to pinch yourself and say, I can't believe I'm here. Yeah. Oh my God, how did I get here? Take us there. Where were you?
Well, it goes back a little ways, because by the time I was Secretary of State, I'd been in the White House before as Special Assistant to George H.W. Bush, and then National Security Advisor, and then Secretary. But there were really two moments as a younger person in the White House. So I got the chance to be the White House Soviet Specialist between 1989 and 1991. It was the end of the Cold War. It doesn't really get better than that. And going into the Kremlin for the first time in the presidential limousine was just like, you know, for a Soviet specialist, that was amazing. Sitting on the White House lawn with Mikhail Gorbachev and Raisa Gorbachev, just me, getting ready to take them to California. That was amazing. But the one that I remember most was my very first meeting in the Oval Office, where I was the note taker for a meeting in just after we'd gotten into office, I think it was probably February 1st or something, with President George H.W. Bush. And it was a meeting with our ambassador in Moscow, Jack Matlock, who'd come back to brief the president on rapidly unfolding events in Moscow. And so we're sitting there, and I'm sitting there thinking, wow, this is the Oval Office. Oh my goodness, that's the president's desk. Oh, good grief, I've seen that fireplace. We were about a third through the meeting, and I thought, I haven't taken notes. And I decided at that point I wasn't really along for the tour. I'd better get to work. So that's the moment I remember most.
Yes. So you told us about difficult heads of state or challenging ones. What about a memorable one?
Yes.
One that you came home and said, this is an amazing head of state, and here's why.
Well, there were some amazing heads of state. I think Angela Merkel is an amazing head of state. To manage Germany and the European Union in the way she does is remarkable. Nelson Mandela was probably the most remarkable person I met. I mean, his very carriage and visage was a reminder that this was somebody who, despite years and years in a jail cell, had somehow managed to see a multi-ethnic, multiracial South Africa. Not a man who came out of jail and said, now we have our chance to repress them, but who actually became a symbol of unity for white South Africans too. And I found him just remarkable. But I think the most remarkable visit that I ever had was with Ariel Sharon. Ariel Sharon was like a little tank driver, you know. He sort of walked like this, and he wasn't very tall, but he was very wide, and he would sort of walk along. And he was one of the few people I knew who actually spoke English better than he understood it. He had a lot of phrases that he would just repeat, and you would say to yourself, oh, he speaks English really well. And then you'd say something else, and he'd repeat the phrase, and you'd think, oh, he's just repeating phrases. Yes. He has no idea what he's really saying. So it was always a little complicated with him. But he invited me, as secretary, out to his farm, which is a place that he loved very dearly. And there he was in a different state of mind. And he talked about the future and how he didn't want to rule over Palestinians and how Jews had to divide Judea and Samaria and how hard that was. But it was remarkable. He also took me, by the way, to see his sheep. And he knew every single one of them. And he said, do you like sheep? And I said, I'm a city girl, Prime Minister, hoping that he wasn't going to ask me to actually touch one or something. And so, but that time on his farm, just to see his evolution as the Prime Minister of Israel, which is a remarkable country. I loved going there. I loved going to the Middle East in general. But I loved going to Israel. If you're religious as I am, and you see the holy city and the way that the light comes up at sunrise and lowers at sunset, it's clear that something very special happened there. It's an otherworldly light in the holy city. And there's so much heartache and so much pain there. And to see Sharon, who was associated with some of the hardest line moments in Israel's history, trying to work toward peace was really, really gratifying.
And yet, as you put it earlier, we've gone backwards, not forwards.
Yeah, we've gone backwards, not forwards.
It's very sad.
And it is, and it's getting tougher because the demographics no longer favor a two-state solution. The hardest line elements on both sides are starting to be the largest parts of the population because of policies that were pursued with ultra-Orthodox Jews. The number of children that they're having is quickly outstripping others, and they're becoming harder and harder line. And on the Palestinian side, Palestinians who believe in a two-state solution are my age and older. Because, again, policies, demographic policies can make a huge difference. Hania, who was the Hamas prime minister in Palestinian territories, had 11 children, and he had 13 brothers and sisters. It's the fundamentalists on the Muslim side that are also changing the population demographics of the region. So if we're going to get it done, we are going to have to get it done pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm. You were at the Berlin Wall when the Berlin Wall made significant history.
Yes.
How was that?
Well, I got to, let me just, we were there in the White House when the Berlin Wall actually fell. And kind of a funny little story. So we were really busy once we hit the ground in February of 1989. Gorbachev was doing all kinds of things. Countries were changing their social system overnight. The Cold War was winding down, and we were watching events in Germany just intensely because it was clear that East Germany was coming apart and we might be facing something really historic, but we didn't know quite what. So the phone rings that day, and Brent Scowcroft's secretary says, Brent wants you to come over immediately and brief the president on what's going on in Berlin. Well, we were so busy, we actually weren't watching what was going on in Berlin. And our brilliant intelligence apparatus had not told us that the wall was falling. And so Flo said, turn on CNN. So that's how we found out that the Berlin Wall had actually been breached. We turned on CNN. So we rushed over to see President Bush, and we said, you must go to Berlin. for Kennedy and for Reagan and for all the American presidents, for Truman, who've waited for this day. And he said, what would I do? Dance on the wall? He said, this is a German moment, not an American one. And I learned so much from him in that moment and about that president. He was not going to make it about him. He wasn't going to make it a moment of personal triumph. This was a German triumph. We had a chance then to actually unify Germany. I was on the White House representative on the team that did German unification. And I remember on July 1st, when finally, on the way to German unification, all of the barriers came down, all of those guard posts that for years people had tried to flee through to get from East Germany into West Germany. And as my driver was German, taking me to the American embassy. And in the old days, the German driver had to get out, and an American driver would take over at the checkpoint and drive in. And they had told this German driver, now you can drive through. And as we approached, you could see he was getting more and more nervous. And then we went through. Not a guard, not a checkpoint, nothing. And he began to cry. He began to weep. And I thought, this is a great geostrategic moment, but it's also an amazing moment for these people, and that President Bush had been so right. It was a German moment, not an American one.
Mm-hmm. You spoke earlier about 9/11 yeah. being one of those moments in a different kind of way. And in your book, No Higher Honor, you talk about how you were the first person to call President Bush to tell him about this. And I just want to read a couple of those pieces. You said, I went down to the Situation Room for my staff meeting. I was going around the table to hear from the senior directors when Tony burst in with a note. A second plane had hit the World Trade Center. People have told me that I said, rather calmly, I have to go. Maybe. But at that moment, I knew that there had been a terrorist attack, and I was shaken to my core. And I'm skipping a bit. The Secret Service came and said, Dr. Rice, you must go to the bunker. Now, planes are hitting buildings. And he said, he didn't answer, and the Secret Service lifted me physically and pushed me toward the bunker. Take us there in that moment. What exactly happened? Yeah. You've already said that you were scared the day after. Yes, you weren't sure what's happening.
Well, after the first plane went in, we thought it was an accident, and I called President Bush. You'll remember he was at an education event in Florida. And to show you our pre-9/11 thinking, I had not gone with him, neither had the Deputy National Security Advisor. It was going to be a domestic trip. That's how we thought of it. And so he was without his principal advisors, but I got him on the phone, and I said, a plane's hit the World Trade Center. He said, strange accident. And I thought it might be a small plane, but then they had told me, no, it was a commercial airliner. Then, as you relate, I learned that a second plane had hit the World Trade Center. And at that point, I thought, this is a terrorist attack. And I went into the Situation Room to try to reach Colin Powell. He was in Peru. Don Rumsfeld, they said, his phone is just ringing and ringing and ringing. And we looked behind us on TV, and a plane had hit the Pentagon. And that's when the Secret Service came. Now, when the Secret Service wants to escort you under those circumstances, they don't really escort you. They do. They pick you up, and they kind of carry you. And I remember sort of vaguely being levitated toward the bunker and thinking, no, 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 I have to make a phone call. And I called my aunt and uncle in Birmingham. You have to know the Rices and Rays. They would have made it to Washington if they had not known I was okay. I said, I'm fine. And then I called the president. And he said, I'm coming back. I said, stay where you are. I actually raised my voice to him. I said, stay where you are. We're under attack. It's not safe here. And then I went to the bunker, and two scenes that I'll never forget, Norm Mineta, the transportation secretary, trying to track tail numbers on a legal pad, because we had to ground all civilian aviation. Every plane had become a potential missile. And then the vice president on the phone with the president saying, Mr. President, if a plane is not identifying itself properly, should the Air Force shoot it down? And the president gave the order. And then when that plane went down in the field in Pennsylvania, we thought we'd shot it down. And the vice president kept saying to the Pentagon, you must know whether you engaged a civilian aircraft. They kept saying, we don't know, we can't confirm, we can't confirm. And so for an awful 10, 12 minutes, we thought that the American Air Force had shot down an innocent civilian aircraft. And it's in that context that I think you have to understand the fear. I've heard people say they led from fear. Yes, yes, fear that it would happen again. And from that moment on, the president said, I will do everything that is legal and everything that is within our values to make sure that it doesn't happen again. But it was a simply terrifying day. And for me, it sort of came full circle on the Thursday. We went out to the Pentagon to visit with the rescue workers. And as we were coming off the highway onto the ramp, you could see the hole in the Pentagon, and it was still smoldering. And there were rescue workers there who'd worked for 48 hours digging people, bodies out. And so we walked among them. And then I was driven home, really shaken, and I thought, what is that smell? And it was a smell of soot and smoke in my clothes. I went upstairs and I took a long, long shower just trying to get rid of the smell. And later on that night, I flipped on the TV and the British were playing at Trafalgar Square. They were playing the American National Anthem. And that's when I came unglued. And I sobbed for all that we'd lost. And I thought, at the time even, that we'd somehow lost our innocence as a country. We had not been attacked on our territory since the War of 1812. And we'd come to think that the great oceans protected us. But we'd learned in that incident that from ungoverned spaces, Afghanistan was the fifth poorest country in the world. It was essentially ungoverned. That's why Al-Qaeda was able to operate there. At the cost of maybe $300,000, they'd brought down the Twin Towers, blown a hole in the Pentagon, and those brave passengers had been lost over a field in Pennsylvania. And it's why today we worry about ungoverned spaces, like Somalia and Libya, and that huge swath of territory between Iraq and Syria, where ISIS operates, a group, by the way, so brutal that Al-Qaeda expelled them. Just put, wrap your arms around that, your head around that. Al-Qaeda expelled them. And so that's why our innocence was lost that day.
Dr. Rice, a couple of years ago, we had General Colin Powell here. He serves on the National Advisory Board of High Point University, for which we're very grateful. And I asked him a question. I asked him a question that continues to be in the discussion circles of America. And the question has to deal with Iraq and our activity there. And I asked him if he had any regrets about that. With some frequency, your name comes up
yes.
along the Iraq discussion. Do you have any regrets about Iraq?
Oh, I do. I do. I don't regret removing Saddam Hussein from power. This was a brutal dictator who put hundreds of thousands of people in mass graves, who killed 1 million people in the war with Iran, who dragged us into war twice before the invasion of 2003, and who shot at our airplanes every day as they were just patrolling to try to keep his forces under, who gassed Kurds and used chemical weapons against Iranians and Kurds. He needed to go. And imagine the Middle East today with Saddam Hussein chasing a weapon of mass destruction alongside the Iranians. I don't regret having him go. I do regret that the intelligence was wrong, because I think the argument was a good one, that he was someone who had used weapons of mass destruction before and was likely to try to do so again. I also regret that we didn't get right early enough some of the institutions, some of the efforts to help the Iraqis get to a more democratic state. The fact is, you know, people these days say, well, maybe people just aren't right for democracy or it's not time for them. Well, that's a fine thing for us to say, sitting here where we can say what we think and worship as we please and we're free from the knock of the secret police at night. But no, they aren't ready. I believe that everybody's ready for democracy. But the Iraqis had to learn to use their institutions. And the one thing that might have made me think really differently about what we did is if we had thought that we would not stay the course with them. That we would, when they were pretty stable in 2011, that we would leave. And I think that was an historic mistake. I think the Iraqis still have a chance, probably have a better chance than the Syrians. But that would have made me think twice about whether intervening made sense. It is simply not true that we overthrew Saddam Hussein to bring democracy to Iraq. We overthrew Saddam Hussein because we believed he was a security threat. But having done that, you had to ask, what is our obligation to the Iraqis to help them build new institutions where Kurds and Shia and Sunni can work together? And it was our obligation to help them do that.
Does it worry you that we still live in a world that is in such turmoil? Every day we read, we watch, we hear about quadrants of our world that seems to be in turmoil. Blame religion, blame politics, blame decision making at the highest places. The result is the same, it's turmoil. In that context, what is it that worries you about America?
Well, it worries me that there are those who believe that we are no longer, as a country, willing to stand for the very system that prospered and kept peace from the end of World War II through the collapse of the Soviet Union. A world that was based on free trade and, most importantly, free peoples, and defended by the United States of America. NATO was amazing. You know, we stood between Joseph Stalin and Europe until Germany could be whole and free, until Eastern Europe could be free. We stood with Japan until it became a vibrant democracy, no longer at war with its neighbors. And that's why the world was peaceful and prosperous for a long time. And it troubles me that there are those who believe that we no longer have the stomach for it. Because the truth of the matter is, either we do, or people who don't share our values will fill that vacuum. That's the choice. It's not a choice that somebody else takes up the mantle of free markets and free peoples. It's a choice of we take it up, or the Chinese do. We take it up, or Vladimir Putin does. We take it up, or ISIS does. Now, I believe that it is also that we have lost a sense of who we are. Not just what we've done, but who we are. And that's really what keeps me up at night. If you ask the proverbial man from Mars, who are these Americans? He asked you, who are these Americans? You would have to say, well, you know, they don't share ethnicity, religion. They're Muslim and they're Christian and they're Jewish and some of them are nothing at all. They don't share nationality. Their ancestors have come from every corner of the earth, and they continue to come from every corner of the earth. The man from Mars might say, well, what in the world is it that holds them together? You would say, well, it's this aspiration. It's a belief that it doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going. You can come from humble circumstances, you can do great things. And they really believe that, and that makes them American. Today, I worry that those elements that have made that true, particularly a high-quality public education. For too many kids, I can look at your zip code and I can tell whether you're going to get a good education. And for a country that is united by an aspiration, that could be the death knell of our democracy. And so I worry about who we are becoming. Two countries, two nations, one capable and one not. One prepared for the modern economy and one not. One fearful of the future and one still optimistic about the future. And we can't survive that way. And we've got to find a way to tap into residual optimism rather than overwhelming fear. Because to simply tell people, yes, you are angry and fearful and you should be, because you're getting a raw deal from fill in the blank, whoever that is. It goes back to what my parents and their friends in that little community in Birmingham always said. Don't ever treat yourself as a victim. Don't ever give somebody that kind of power over you. And then we've got to make sure that people, regardless of their circumstances, get to great universities like this and other universities around this country. Whatever they're going to do, 2 years at a community college, full four-year education, whatever they're going to do, that we recapture that belief that doesn't matter where you came from.
You know, at Hyper University, we're challenged with this every day. How do you make college affordable? How do you interpret value in ways that people can acknowledge its usefulness? How do you create diversity and inclusivity in a way that makes sense? How do you prepare your students for the world as it's going to be, not as it is, not as it was? Our School of Education works very hard at graduating teachers who know that they're not going to be paid amply for their hard work, and yet who have the conviction and the passion
yes.
to create the kind of classrooms and the kind of learning opportunities you speak of. I need to ask you a simple question. And I suspect there's more than one viewer watching us today who is asking this question. Why haven't you run for president?
You have to know your own DNA. And I know that I love policy. I know that I was fortunate enough, blessed enough, to serve as Secretary of State of this great country. I love international politics as vocation and advocation. And there's nothing greater than having that opportunity and that honor. I know that I don't love politics. And I saw it firsthand. I was on the campaign trail with George W. Bush very early. And he is a great politician, great retail politician, great values, great center, but great politician. So we'd go to 5-6 events in a day in those early days. Some of them were kind of small. And he was as good with 5 people in the room and 5,000 in the room. And then at the end of the 5 or 6 events, he was raring to go to the next, and I was raring to go back to the hotel because it is energizing for great politicians. Mm. They have a fingertip feel for the population, and I admire people who run for office, and heaven knows we need them. Because if you haven't noticed, we don't treat our president very well, whoever's in the office. You know, on the day that the president is inaugurated, he's the most amazing, brilliant human being God ever created. And a year later, it's how did we ever elect that idiot, right? And so we are difficult people to govern, actually. So you really have to want to do it. I'll always do public service. I'm a great believer in public service.
I want to really believe what you just said, but I find it difficult because you were the provost at Stanford University. That's much harder than being president of the United States.
Well, it is true that when you're the provost, you know, you have a faculty and they are tenured and they think they have their own views. But when you're provost at a great university or president at a great university, you get to walk across these campuses every day and you really get to see the future. You get to see that there are young people who really are still optimistic. Mm. And I don't know about you, but I think this may be the most public-minded generation of students I've ever encountered. Mm-hmm. I've been teaching for more than 30 years. Yes, Stanford hired me when I was 11, absolutely. but in this entire, I've never met a group yes. of students who wanted more to do something bigger than themselves. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're kind of confused on how to do that. Mm-hmm. Weren't we all at 19 or 20 years old? But they want to be a part of something bigger. And I think they are the reason that we should be all be optimistic. They're going to innovate. They're going to change the way that we do things. They're going to take on poverty at home and poverty abroad and climate change, and they're going to make a difference. And as a university person, you get to see it every day. And that's what I love about being a university person.
We see it here, 120,000, 130,000 hours of students who give service yes. to the community at yes. large and do it with passion, yes. conviction, dedication, yes. commitment.
I hope you've enjoyed this interview, which is a part of High Point University's Access to Innovators series. You can watch more interviews anytime online at highpoint.edu/innovators.
If this place were full of college students and you wanted to give them one piece of advice that they would savor and that they could apply in their life for maximum advantage, given your years of experience on the campus of Stanford University and your years of experience traveling across the world and meeting all kinds of people with all kinds of backgrounds, what would that piece of advice be?
Well, I will tell them tomorrow that I hope they find things that they're passionate about, because passion in life is really important. But I've been watching the debates on our campuses, and I would tell every student, don't seek your comfort zone. Get out of your comfort zone. Do something that's really hard for you. Be around people who think differently. Because you actually don't get to know yourself by going deeper into your comfort zone. You get to know yourself by being outside of what you're comfortable doing. One of the great experiences in my life was going to study language in Moscow. In 1979, Soviet Union, not a liberalizing place at the time, I went with two other girls to study language at Moscow State University. I had never been outside the United States of America except to skate in Canada. And we landed, and it was about 11 o'clock at night. Our plane was late from Paris. And there was just one old lady moving dust with the broom. No cars, no nothing. We hired an off-duty cab driver who happened to be around to take us out to the university. It was shut down. We thought, maybe we can get a hotel room. We went back into the city. They gave us one hotel room with a light bulb screwed in the ceiling for all three of us. And I just lay there thinking, I could have studied Italy. Why am I here? But after that experience, I knew I could survive just about anything. You do best, you learn most about yourself when you're willing to challenge yourself outside that which makes you feel good about yourself, that which makes you comfortable, people who are like you. Seek out difference, I would tell them.
Dr. Rice, I cannot begin to tell you what an inspiration you are. You have departed adversity and you have entered the zone of abundance. And by that, I mean it in its widest spectrum. I mean it in the sense of the impact that you've made. I think that the merit of a true leader is someone who demands and commands respect, even when people, obviously when people agree with them, but even when people disagree with them. And I think you have done a spectacular job of crossing that zone of saying, I speak the truth, I speak with reason, you're entitled to your opinions, but see my point of view as well. And together, we can march onward and forward to make America a better place and make the world a better place in which to live, to raise a family, to work, and to influence all those who cross our paths. I thank you very much for coming to the campus of Highpoint University, and I wish for you greatness. I still think that in all of your genius, you have made a grave error in not running for president. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Condoleezza Rice.